Here's what I want you to do with this screencast. I want you to take notes. I am going to take every presentation here that was assigned to students, and I'm going to add some additional information. At the end of each section, there will be a brief summary slide. I need you to pause this screencast, write down two or three thoughts, try to figure out a main point, and then the next slide will be repetitive. It's just going to give you my thoughts. So let's get started here. I want you to keep in mind that these presentations are from the 1950s and in the 1960s. And for the most part, all of these topics will impact the future, and some of them have their origins in the past, one being like the Vietnam War and the fight for civil rights. So let's get started with the first group, which is 1968. So this group was asked to address two things, two terms, the New Left and the Tale of Two Sixties, this particular concept here. It's really just looking at the groups on the left. Remember, the groups on the left usually are advocating for change. And in the 1920s, some of the groups that were on the left addressed these issues that are here. But the left of the 60s, the New Left, addresses some of the same issues, but then they add a couple of new ones. And the New Left, this umbrella term, that's designed to address all of the groups, like the fight to end segregation with Brown versus Board of Ed, which was still an issue going on in the 1920s. What about the women protesting Miss America beauty pageant, the New York radical women? Keep in mind, the old left of the 20s was concerned about suffrage. Here they seem to be concerned about the portrayal of women. What about Mexican Americans advocating for bilingual education, Native Americans engaging in what becomes known as fish-ins, and the homophile movement, or led by the Mattachine Society, who are advocating for gay rights? One of the things I want you to think about with all of these particular new leftist groups coming forward, that by the late 60s, there seems to be a collective unifying movement in the anti-war movement that seeks to try to unify all of these groups, or all of these groups kind of have a particular view that is similar with regard to the conflict in Vietnam. Why? Well, because the Vietnam War is getting out of hand. This is an image from the Tet Offensive, where the individual here, supported by the United States, executes this individual who may or may not be the enemy, and I think there's a consensus that he was the enemy, but that this individual had executed him without any sort of trial. It's just one of those events that tell the American people this war is just way out of control. So the Tale of Two Sixties, this concept is just looking at the 60s and looking at the early 60s to the late 60s, where the early 60s, things were a little more submissive. People were more willing to boycott, whereas here they're willing to riot. They're possibly willing to get violent. Why? Because the 60s was a violent time, especially when you get to the midpoint, the Malcolm X assassination, after the Medgar Evers assassination, Robert Kennedy's assassination, King, and you start to see all of these individuals getting frustrated and annoyed with these movements, thinking we're never really going to solve anything unless we do something drastic. Groups like the Weathered Underground come into existence. They initially were part of SDS, Students for a Democratic Society. Some of its hardcore members split and created a terrorist group called the Weathered Underground. This is your time to write a quick summary, so I want you to pause it before we move on to the next slide. So my summary, again, I just want to make sure you look at the Tale of Two Sixties and the New Left. Treat them like definitions and the images from television, which is really going to be about the next topic. This question here, what was America like in the 50s and was it equal for everyone? You might want to keep that question in mind throughout these series of presentations here. I've selected these two songs that I think they give a pretty good example of the differences between the early 60s and the late 60s. Even though they were written in 71 or released in 71, I think they still have something to say. The first one is by Marvin Gaye. There's too many of you crying. Brother, brother, brother. There's far too many of you. You know we've got to find a way. And looking at Gil Scott Heron, the revolution will not be televised. Definitely a different message here.
able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Xerox in four parts without commercial interruptions.
So I think this particular song here is really looking at that frustration by the late 60s. Let's move on to the next group, which is television. Now, this particular image, although it might seem odd, and what is that transition about, it's really getting us set up for the TV group, which provides the visuals, an additional breaking point where people are looking at some of the images and thinking things are just getting way out of hand here. And this TV dinner, which is actually a marketing ploy, they've taken the box for the TV dinner and they've tried to recreate a television. Like, these two circles are actually trying to play the role of knobs, the volume and the channel tuner or the changer. So the TV dinners, they become popular in the 1950s. I just did a quick Google search here just to get you thinking about that. 1950s, you're going to start to see a lot of processed food. How much of an impact? Well, had to have some impact when you start to see different TV dinners, marketing, and trying to cater to a different cultural group. Why? Because not everyone has a Chinese grandmother. So maybe you've never tasted real fine old-fashioned Chinese home cooking. Keep in mind, other groups would also be impacted, like the Niblets Mexicorn. Nothing like some processed corn. Look at that, those Niblets, the Jolly Green Giant, looking as Mexican as he possibly can for the 1950s going into the 60s. These sources actually come from the book Food is Love by Catherine Parkin. Just throwing it out there. Here we see Billy and Timmy watching television, and what are they eating? Well, they might be eating, oh wow, look at this, Chungking's frozen food. Here's a switch for shrimp or chicken chow mein. Serve it over waffles or spaghetti. Yum, how nice. What would they be watching? Maybe they're watching the Tet Offensive. Maybe they're watching Napalm Girl. Maybe they're watching the Birmingham protest where black civil rights demonstrators were attacked by dogs. So let's make a television transition to another presenter here, which is about the impact of visuals on election. Here I'm just trying to go back a little to the 1800s and give you some sort of historiography on technology. You know, if this was the 1858 debate between Lincoln and Douglas, you would have to actually go out and watch this debate in person. Unlike the 20s, where maybe you're listening to this thing on the radio, two candidates talking about their policies. By the time we get to the 60s, you start to see television being used in elections. And one in particular is the first televised debate between Kennedy and Nixon. Nixon, who was coming off of some sort of sickness, this individual really was viewed as the loser, according to the people watching the debate. However, the people listening, they kind of felt he won. That goes to show the impact of this particular medium. So let's take a look at this clip here.
Sunday Morning Almanac, September 26th, 1960. 50 years ago today, the day American politics entered not just a new Republican, John F. Kennedy, the Democrat, met in the first ever televised debate.
I'm out swinging.
Let me see the tight shot on.
In the moments before, both candidates warily tested the microphones.
You hear me now speaking?
And check. As Don Hewitt recalled years later, the recently ill and still pale Richard Nixon happened to overhear the tanned and fit-looking Kennedy decline Hewitt's offer of professional TV makeup.
Nixon heard Kennedy say no. He needed some.
Just a side note here, when we look at this Electoral College map, Lyndon Johnson was picked by Kennedy to be the vice president for Kennedy, because there's a split in the Democratic Party, and Kennedy, somebody who represent a Northern Ivy League elite within the Democratic Party, felt that he possibly is not going to win unless he gets the Southern Democrat support, which is precisely what Lyndon Johnson winds up bringing to the Kennedy ticket. That will be important when we get to a later topic. I just selected this particular image here just to look at the, again, role technology has played in elections. And with this particular piece here, you see the Obama running for presidency. And he is able to use social media and Twitter as a way to just generate money. So just technological 1800 elections, you're going out to see it. 20s, you're listening to it on the radio. 60s, you're watching on television. And here we are today, where the role of the internet is impacting elections. It's just another technological change. Last thing about the television topic here that I want to address is the declining family values. And the declining family values, looking at this nuclear family enjoying their dinner, but that might change when you start to see families watching the television, and that might play more of a role as far as a family bonding unit in comparison to previously when people were eating dinner and talking to each other. And you might be able to make a connection between that and individuals today on their phones. TV summary, you know the deal. I need you to just do a quick pause and see what you come up with. And here's my list here. Radio and the technological changes that the TV brings with regard to impacting an election, as well as changing social norms. And I'll reinforce that point using this video here, which is a video of the civil rights demonstration in Birmingham. Now, regardless of how you feel about segregation, watching this video may possibly change your view, or maybe confirm it, depending on where you stand. But for the most part, this gets pretty out of hand for Americans, seeing civil rights demonstrators being attacked by dogs, beaten up, and sprayed with fire hoses. And again, it's about the impact of television. Seeing these visuals might change your opinion on segregation.